Good evening. I'm Stephanie Towles, and welcome to Workers in Berks. This is the program that is sponsored by the Berks County Labor Council, and we come together each month to talk about issues that are affecting our workers and our unions and our families here in Berks County. I'm substituting today for Richie, who unfortunately was not able to join us, but I'm very happy to be here. Richie will be here again next month, and I'm excited because I have a very special guest today, and we actually have a very special program because our format today will be 1 hour long when normally it's just 30 minutes. So I would like to introduce to you State Representative Eddie Day Pashinski, and he comes to us from the Scranton area. From the Wilkes-Barre area. And I had an opportunity to hear the representative speak at a function about a month ago, and he just kind of really captured my attention with all that he was saying about the history of how unions have supported workers here in our communities, and he's going to tell some of those stories tonight. But he's also talking about collective bargaining and the threats that we're currently experiencing to collective bargaining here in Pennsylvania. I think it's really important for everyone to hear what he has to say. So welcome, Representative. It's really nice to have you here.
Thank you, Stephanie. It's my pleasure.
So because you're new to Berks County, or our Berks County audience is new to you, I would just like to start with you giving us a little background and telling our audience a little bit about where you're from and what some of your experiences were before joining the legislature.
Okay, sure. Well, thank you very much, and I appreciate the opportunity to be with you. I come from a wonderful town. A blue-collar town, hardworking folks of Nanticoke, Pennsylvania, which is about 10 miles south of Wilkes-Barre, half a double block on West Noble Street. My dad worked in the mines, and my mom worked at J.S. Robb Shoe Store. So I lived on a street where everybody basically had the same kind of living standards, living conditions, and nobody knew that they were really poor. Because we're all about the same. And I don't even want to say that we were poor, but what we had wasn't a heck of a lot, especially compared to today. And because we were a community that was located in the Northeast, the mining industry was huge. Mm-hmm. And so the stories of working in the mines and the tragedies of working in the mines and the children, the boys, the breaker boys that worked outside of the mines picking the coal definitely left an impression on me. And as I grew older, I wasn't sure what I was going to become, but in any case, went to school and became a teacher.
Well, can I just stop you for a second?
Sure.
Because you mentioned the breaker boys. And recently, when I was in Scranton, I learned a lot about the breaker boys at a display at the Scranton Historical Society. And it was a part of history that I really hadn't known much about before. And I also want to say my grandfather was a coal miner in southwest Pennsylvania, down below Pittsburgh.
That's bituminous.
And we were, as kids, we would go visit, and it was a little place called Bronco, Pennsylvania. There's my plug. But it was a company town. There was one store owned by the company in the town. Everyone in the town worked for the mine, and you know, that was my grandfather's life, and then his children went on to do different things.
Yes.
Which sounds a little similar
to
your story.
And again, because of the coal mining history, it provides the evidence of the need for a union. I've always taken the position, if you're an employer and you treat your employees well, respectfully, pay them appropriately, and the right kind of benefits and so on, you would never need a union. But the coal barons abused their power. So yes, everyone had a job, but at the end of the day, they had to purchase everything through the company store.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever they were going to get paid, it went back to the company store. And they also rented from the company, the house they lived in. So basically, there was no way you could possibly get ahead. And if you were a father that had boys, guess where they were going to work? They were going to work in the mines too. So yes, you had a job, but you had no future. And, you know, before the United Mine Workers came to be, there were stories, and I say this in all honesty, where the mule was more important than the human being, than the miner. And there were countless times that miners would get killed in the mines because of the gases, or because of the walls collapsing, or timber would break. If you lived in that area, and since your grandpappy was up there, miners were missing fingers and toes and had many injuries. It was a very difficult job. And of course, black lung became very predominant. And that's from working in the kind of environment that they were in. So the point that I'm making about the mule was, when a miner was actually killed in the mines, they'd bring the miner out, put him on a wagon. The wagon would take him to the home that they lived, take him off the wagon, put him on the porch, and that's it. They'd go back. There was no service, there was no memorial, there was nothing. So that's the reason why the United Mine Workers came to be, because there was such abuse of humanity and such unfairness that these miners got together. And the stories that you hear where the coal barons then would bring in their own private security, and that's where you had the Molly Maguires, and that's where you had, you know, the deaths in this process. And finally, what came to be, the truth came out, that this was abuse to American citizens. And as a result, the United Mine Workers were organized. And one of the things they fought for was, instead of having a 14-hour workday, they would work for a 12-hour or a 10-hour workday. Many of them worked from sunup to sundown. Mm-hmm. And that's why unions came to be, because most of the employees were abused. And today, one of the main points I want to make today is that, yeah, unions may not be perfect. Some people may not be completely enamored by them. But I know, and you know, and anybody that's gone through this process, understand that unions, through collective bargaining, have created the middle class.
Yes.
Because it's through the negotiations, you negotiated salary, you negotiated working conditions, you negotiated benefits, you negotiated pensions. And what had happened over time, when you became a union shop, or if you had a union in your business, you were able to attract the best employees because you paid them well,
yes.
They were treated well. And as a result, the non-union employer had to improve their standards in order to get a quality employee. Otherwise,
it lifted
everybody up. Mm-hmm. And the thing about history, we live in the moment. We live in this bubble. We're living today. And we lose sight of what's happened. But there are times you have to go back to understand why certain things were established.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why I'm so enthused about making these points, that people should not be condemning the efforts of those unions, because as they succeed, it lifts all boats.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do the unions go a little bit beyond where they should? If so, that's why we have the bargaining table. That's mm-hmm. where you settle your differences. And that way there, we can continue to make America great and continue to maintain our prominence. So that's a little background, you know, from being in Nanticoke, Pennsylvania. And go ahead.
Oh, well, I just wanted to, go back to kind of where we were, because as you just explained so much, you didn't talk about your union experience, which was in a very different area than the coal industry.
Well, so it's sort of, I'm going to tell you something which might, for some of your listeners, might seem peculiar. But as a teacher, we did not have certain rights. And as a female teacher, you had less rights than a male. Going back many years, as a matter mm-hmm. of fact, if you got pregnant while you were teaching, they could fire you. Mm-hmm. There were no protections. So the board could fire and hire at will. There were no protections whatsoever until Act 195 came along, which was back in about 1970.
Okay.
And that was the first time that you could take teachers and they could bargain across the table to the school district's administrators and to the school district's school directors. And I can tell you that it was a unique experience because those school directors were absolutely offended that teachers had the audacity to sit at the table and discuss terms and conditions. Mm-hmm. And I tell the story, and this is the God's honest truth. One of my main goals was to make sure that all the students in our jointure were being taught out of the same textbook. So as a music teacher, I used to travel from school to school. Mm-hmm. So therefore, I got to see every school inside and out, the children, the teachers, the principal. And I was amazed to find out that when I went to one elementary school, the kids were being taught English out of this book. And then at a different elementary school, they were being taught English out of another book. And this had a copyright date of like 1919, and this had a copyright date of 1930. So one of my goals in the negotiations was, let's try to coordinate our curriculum, mm-hmm. and let's try to coordinate our books.
So you weren't just bargaining for the teacher issues like teacher pay and teacher benefits. You were bargaining for the good of the students. You were using your bargaining tools as a way to improve the overall
quality.
Education, the quality of the education for the students.
Absolutely, and I'll never forget, and I won't mention the gentleman's name. He said, who the heck, and you can take the word heck any way you want, and who the heck are you to tell us what books to buy? And I said, I'm not telling you what books to buy, I'm just suggesting that we're all the children of each grade is using the same instructional material. So that experience was invaluable to me because I could see the barriers that were before us. And yes, we did begin to bargain our salary, and we did begin to bargain our work days and the time to provide a teacher to make sure they were able to prepare for their classes and so mm-hmm. on. So it was all the terms and conditions. So I understand what it was like. And to be honest with you, they tried to fire me many times. Because I was one of the negotiators. I served on the first Act 195 negotiating team, and they didn't like that at all. And we were doing everything legal. We were doing everything professional. We were being honorable to them. We were being respectful to them. But because it was the first time it ever happened, it was unacceptable to them. So it took years to be able to have Act 195 take place, and as a result, all the school districts eventually got accustomed to that process. And because of that, you were then able to attract better, more qualified teachers. And teaching, it's not just about the money. Oh. You have to have it within you.
Yeah.
Got it?
It's a calling.
And as a teacher, as I would witness my class, as I looked at my children in my class, you could tell which children had certain talents and certain abilities. Mm-hmm. And that's what makes the world wonderful. Mm-hmm. And that's why, you know, we should respect all vocations. And it was an uplifting moment, you know, moments for me as a teacher. I taught for 38 years, and I absolutely loved it. Not saying it was easy, not saying it wasn't a challenge. Kids can always be a challenge. But I loved them, and they knew that. And we were trying to, you know, improve their lives through teaching them as much as we could. And the idea was the more you learn, the more you know, the better your chance of being a success when you become an adult. But all of that helped mold me, and I was a union member from the very first day that I was a teacher. And I'll never forget, a wonderful secretary said to me, Eddie, you know, you're a nice boy, everybody likes you, but why are you joining that union? And I said, well, but the union represents me. Oh, you don't want to join the union, that's no good. Well, obviously I didn't listen to that secretary. I was a you know, the building rep, and then eventually became the president and served on a variety of things and went through strikes, which were absolutely brutal.
That was going to be my next question, because I've heard you mentioned that era, like between 1967 and 1971-72, and I've talked to other people who were in the field at that time who have talked about the strikes. And nowadays, talking about strikes in school districts is almost like a taboo, like teachers shouldn't go on strike. And Can you share a little bit about why it was necessary at the time, and you know, was it a simple decision, or was that a complicated choice for people to make, and why did they make that choice, and what impact did it have?
Well, first of all, the choice to strike should always be your last choice, and it's gut-wrenching, because and people have to know that most of us that were teachers in Nanticoke lived in Nanticoke. That was our hometown. Our children went to Nanticoke. It was family, so you never wanted to do that. But the school board determines certain characteristics of that school. And at the time that we had our problems, we were the lowest paid teachers in that area, mm-hmm. by a considerable amount. And we were looking for some parity. And, you know, being negotiators and sitting at a bargaining table, there's certain skills that you have to learn. And we were novices, to be quite honest. And so were the board members. And then you have some professionals that come in, an attorney on their side, attorney on our side. But it got to be so divisive that, I mean, I needed a police escort for my children at points.
Oh, wow.
There were so many threats. People were trying to fire you. And it was because of misinformation. And that's one of the things I hope we get out today about making sure that the people get to hear the truth. And I've always believed that if you give the truth to the people, sometimes you don't like the truth, but if you give them the truth, over time they're going to make the right decision. And that's what happened. It was a prolonged period of time. We went through selective strikes. We went through the all-out strike. So we knew what that was like to go without pay and to have to go and borrow, you know, to provide for your family. So all of those things were involved. But you know what? It was that non-bloody war that had to take place to elevate the standards of that school. And the point that I want to make is, your school is the heart of that community. And if your school is educating those children and those kids are learning, that is an attraction for other people to come to your community.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So we were trying to make our school directors understand, look, we have a good school. We can make it a great school. Let's make these improvements. One of the things we were trying to get as a music teacher, I was trying to make sure we could get recorders, those little flutophone mm-hmm. things, so that the kids could learn, because I knew the value of that one little, what appears to be a toy, that little instrument, was valuable. The strike was able to get money enough so that we could buy, you know, recorders. But the point is, it took time. There were a lot of blood, sweat, and tears. And in our history, people suffered, and they gave up so much in order to make things better for those of us that are today. And I might also say people died too. You know, people were killed in these conflicts. And there's no way we should go back to that situation again. I'm concerned about the divisiveness in the country and the divisiveness in the state mm-hmm. because partly of misinformation and rhetoric that's mm-hmm. Tempered so that it actually divides people and creates this hatred.
Well, and as we move in that direction, part of when you talk about people not having misinformation, people having good information, people need to know and understand that it's good information.
Yes.
And one of the things that public schools do is they make sure that they're educating every student, regardless of the family background, the family income. And because you taught in that community where you lived and where you were from, I'm imagining a lot of those children in those schools were the children of minors, or were the children of families who had a different aspiration for their children than the work that they had done in their lives.
You are 100% correct.
And in many cases, it was the public school that was kind of like your only ticket out. Is that fair to say?
You're 100% correct. And that is the incredible power of a public school. I might be a perfect example of that. My father said to me, you're not going in mines. You're not going to work in the mines. You're going to school. You're going to learn. I didn't know that I was going to become a music teacher, and I certainly never had in my plans that I would become a representative, of which, by the way, I'm extremely humbled and proud to serve. It's one of the greatest positions that you could ever imagine. Not always fun, definitely challenging. But I am I'm not just the only example. All of those kids that went to those public schools came from the miners' families, mm-hmm. came from those half a double blocks, mm-hmm. came from people that you had food on the table. There was nurturing, there was love in the family, but you didn't have a lot of money. And I'll tell you what vacation was. Getting in a car and going across the river to an ice cream stand and getting an ice cream cone, or taking a ride out to Harvey's Lake and going around the lake and looking at stuff, because you didn't have the money, you know, to be able to do anything else. But the point that you made, you know, every one of those kids, and as I told you, when I look at my children that come in, I can tell which kids are coming from a family that's nurturing them and they're providing, and I can tell which child needs that love and that extra help. But you know what? That child that needs that extra help, if they get it, they can be that lawyer, they can be that doctor, they can be that teacher, they can be that contractor, they can be that entrepreneur. That's why education is so absolutely critical and so important. And that's why it's important that we make sure we fund appropriately mm-hmm. so that we're able to provide that. And since we're on this education, if I will, there's also something else that I want to make very clear to any one of the listeners that might be listening. Some of the test scores that they bring out now, oh, that's wonderful. If you want to cherry pick, if I want to cherry pick out of my classes and put them in a certain area, I guarantee you I can pick to the point that I know that they'll be getting A's. I know these mm-hmm. kids over there will struggle to get a C. Mm-hmm. But let me make the point. You don't have to always be an A student to become a success.
That's right.
Got it? You mm-hmm. break that logjam to give them the confidence to do whatever it is.
That's
could
right.
be the greatest mechanic.
Yep.
Could be the greatest plumber. Whatever it is. But you should never, ever evaluate your school based upon that test score, because that is not where the key is.
I agree 100%. So this is terrific. I would like to talk a little bit beyond your career as an educator and how you went from a music classroom to the Capitol building in Harrisburg.
Well, throughout my teaching career, I was involved in the political structure, being a representative in PSEA, then the president of the local, and so on. And I discovered as a teacher that it was important to have communication with my legislator, because my legislator was going to legislate laws that would affect me and my family, it would affect my students, it would affect my community. So early on, being part of the PSEA political action team, I would go and I would lobby Senator Musto and Representative Blum and Representative Hassai. And as a result, that's how I began to understand why the political process was important. But I can tell you this, now that I'm a legislator, what I thought I knew was nothing compared to what I'm experiencing today. And if there's any message that I want to get out there to your listeners is, the listener, you that are listening today, and your family, and every American in this country, you are the power. You are the power. You need the information. Please do not listen to one station or read one newscast or listen to one radio. You've got to expand to find the truth so that there is no fake information out there. Because once you have that truth and that information, now you can make the decision. Who should represent you?
Yes.
Who is mm-hmm. telling the truth? Who is really fighting for your interests? And as you and I had the conversation, I've never tried to look at things as a Democrat. I've tried to look at things as an American.
Mm-hmm.
We are Americans. The people that are watching this newscast, we are Americans. And we are too divided right now. If we look at it from the standpoint of, here's a problem. Forget color, race, creed, political party. Here's a problem that's going to affect Americans. How do we bring other Americans in together to solve that problem? And nothing should impede that to make improvements for our constituents, for our citizens.
Mm-hmm.
In our conversation, remember when we were talking, I said the flood of 1972, which was devastating in the Wyoming Valley, it truly, the dikes blew out and just thousands and thousands of homes were inundated. And what I
remember it, but I'll say I remember it because my mother couldn't pick me up from daycare. So I remembered a little different than you do, but she was stuck at work. But anyway, the flood of 72 was tough here in Berks County,
too. For your listeners, try to imagine, you know, the Susquehanna River on both sides of the river with thousands of people, men and women. And what we were doing was sandbagging. So we had trucks come in dumping the sand. We had people shoveling the sand in the sandbags, people carrying up top, people on top, putting the sandbags to try to prevent that river from blowing through. And the reason I say that is because never once did you look on either side and say, hey, are you a Democrat or Republican? Are you a Catholic or are you? No. We were Americans.
That's right.
We were fighting for that. And, you know, 1.3 million Americans died so we could have this freedom, so we could have this incredible thing, you know, called democracy. And that's why we can't give it up. And that's why I'm asking the people out there to find the truth. Don't listen to that one station. You got to go beyond. Keep your mind open. Find out what the truth is, and you'll be able to make the right decision.
That's excellent stuff. That's sort of your philosophical basis for being in office. And you've been in office 11 years now.
Yes.
And can you talk a little bit about, you say you know so much more now than going in. You didn't really understand how much it was going to entail. What are some of the things that you've seen that have changed over the legislative discourse in the last 11 years?
Well, remember when I said, I believe there's more good than bad. And I believe if the people are given the truth, they'll make the right decision. Well, in the legislature, I want to tell everybody out there on both sides of the aisle, Republican and Democrat, there are dedicated and outstanding legislators who work hard every day trying to do what they believe is right for their district. And there are people that we can work with. But as a new legislator coming in, I heard the stories of the very aggressive debate on the floor between Democrats and Republicans. And yet, those people would go out to dinner, and they would work, and they would discuss the issue, work things out, come back again, go and bring their staff and work it out, and try again to move the bar forward for the people. And I saw that. I saw that when I first got elected. As a matter of fact, the first two terms, we were in the majority, albeit a small majority, but we were the majority. And there was a lot of camaraderie across the aisles. 2010 was a new era. Mm-hmm. 2010 came in a new group of people, and their position was, it's this way or no way. And that camaraderie, that sitting down trying to work things out, became progressively more and more and more and more difficult. And that's why I'm coming back to the people, because I think if they realize, if they were to stick together, they have the power to really scare the bejesus out of legislators to come back to the table and fix things, make things better for the people. And I began to understand that there's huge, huge power structure because there's so many interests. Now, some people will use the word lobby and think that that's a bad thing. Lobby's not a bad thing. Every citizen is a lobbyist if you make yourself to be. You come to my office or your representative's office, you make your case. If you're not getting anywhere, you know what you do, folks? You go out and get 6 more people. You get 8 more people. You get 10 more people. And that's the basis of unions,
yes,
to try to help people out. And you continue on that. You know what? It's tough. You no longer can sit back, have your coffee after dinner, and watch your favorite show. You now may have to take some time, gather with your neighbors, come together and say, now how are we going to get this road fixed? How are we going to get this legislation passed that's going to be meaningful for us? There are certain times in history, and now is the time, where people, every person that's a citizen, needs to be involved. And you better be registered to vote, because your power to vote is absolutely incredible. When you think that your power to vote is nothing, politics is crooked, my vote doesn't mean anything, that's baloney. Your power is incredible. And by the way, your power, my power, your power, is the same amount of power as the billionaire, millionaire, or the guy that has 2 cents in his pocket. So, coming back to the idea that you have the power, I began to see who had the power in Harrisburg. And there were certain lobbying groups, there were certain associations that had more juice, I like to say more juice than others. And as you began to track their efforts, if an issue came up that would affect them negatively, they were like flies on honey. They were there immediately making their case.
Visible.
Visible. And also, I want to make it very clear, a lobbyist would educate your senators, your legislators, because they know their issue inside and out. So they would come and visit. Then I would then go to other people, verify this, give me the right information. Is this correct? Is that correct? To help me make my choice whether I'm going to be a yay or a nay. Mm-hmm. And I began seeing how a lot of the power was changing. But one of the main things that changed the structure of good government was huge sums of money. When Citizens United was passed by the Supreme Court and allowed corporations to create S-corps and so on, millions of dollars were now being infused in the system. That changed the system, and I'm going to show. Let me just finish up by telling you why. The reason it changed the system is because a lot of good people that would want to run and would be a great representative or senator maybe would have to raise $20,000 or $30,000 or $50,000 to run. Now, you may have to raise $500,000, $750,000. Where do regular folks get that kind of money?
And you're talking about for people to run to represent here in Pennsylvania. You're not talking about Washington.
No.
You're talking about right here.
I'm talking about right here. In Washington, if you want to run for Congress, years ago, you could run if you were able to raise $100,000, $125,000. Now, if you don't raise $2 million, you're done. Senator, you got to raise $5 to $10 million. You're done. Now, what is that telling you? What is that telling you out there, the people? Too much money has infused, and it's because of that Supreme Court decision. And that's why I'm saying don't allow that money to take away your power of the vote. But your power of the vote is only worth it if you have the truth behind you. Then it means something. Then you can try to vote for that guy or that person that you want to represent you. And that's the thing that has changed dramatically. So now, let's talk about our budget for a moment.
Yes, okay? That's an issue on a lot of people's mind now that we're midway through July. We've passed a budget in Pennsylvania, but we do not have a way to allocate the funds. We don't know where the money's coming from yet.
And I'm just going to throw some things out and let your listeners make up their own mind. For 10 years, I'm now my 11th year, as a Democrat, we've tried to put on what we call a fair severance tax, an extraction tax of natural gas. Pennsylvania is the third largest natural resource of natural gas in the entire world. There's over 100 years of natural gas here. Got it? By the Constitution says you, the people of Pennsylvania, own that gas. I'm trying, and many of my colleagues are, including some Republicans, are trying to get a bill passed that would allow for a fair percent. We're looking at 6% of every 1,000 cubic feet coming out, they would pay the general fund. If we did that in 2010, like we had tried to do, $2.8 billion would have been in our treasury. I'm going to say it again, $2.8 billion. Now look, we do not want to put that business in bankruptcy. That doesn't make any sense. We expect them to make money. But they extracted 5.1 trillion cubic feet of gas out last year, which was worth over $7.88 billion. Do you think out of that you could give a couple hundred million, $300 million to the general fund so that we could balance our budget? So if we did that from 2010 to the present day, we would have had $2.8 billion. And let me say something, folks. Because we have 100 years of natural gas, Once our infrastructure, our pipelines are complete, now they're going to pump it, and they're going to export it. And that price is going to go up, and the people of Pennsylvania won't get what they deserve. So there's one example of something where a large, powerful lobbying firm has been able to hold off a legitimate and a fair natural gas extraction tax for the good of Pennsylvania. That's the kind of thing that needs to stop. I would venture to say that if all the people in Pennsylvania, or those that agreed that this would be a good thing, put the pressure on their representative and their senator, that's the kind of influence that could make that change. Another one is the Delaware loophole. Many people have heard of the Delaware loophole, where major manufacturers, major companies, have been able to use Delaware as their headquarters to transfer profits through Delaware at no tax.
At no tax here in Pennsylvania.
No tax in Pennsylvania. They're doing right. So we've been trying to say, let's close that loophole, lower our corporate net income tax from 9.9, which is one of the highest, but very few of the major companies, about 25-20% of them, pay that. Lower that, maybe that will attract some more people in here. The idea again is we're willing to find out whatever that fair level is. Again, I appreciate the business. We appreciate the business. Pennsylvania is the Keystone State. We have a lot of great workers that are skilled. We have great schools that provide those workers that are skilled. We have great universities and colleges that provide great skills. Pennsylvania is the Keystone State. Let's work together to find the balance. I want the companies to make a profit, but I also want the companies to pay their fair share to the people of Pennsylvania. So there's two areas where we can't do that because the power on the other side refuses to touch that. As a counter, though, which is absolutely astonishing to me, some on the other side want to borrow to pay the debt. Now, you and I both know I have a credit card that's maxed out. I get a new credit card. I now take this credit card and I start paying this one off. Where am I going? I'm going in the hole.
Right.
So that's not good, especially when you have those kinds of sources that you could help defray the cost.
Yeah, with the household budget, you learn that you've got to increase your income if you want to keep spending. You can't just do it in debt.
Exactly. You can't get out of debt by cutting. I want also the people to know that we've been cutting back on staff and on resources ever since 2009. We're basically at the bone in just about every situation. Yes. And all the secretaries have made that claim during the appropriation hearings. There's nothing left in the cupboard, boys. So we need some new reoccurring income. We've also recommended, and I want to make sure everyone's clear on this, we have one of the lowest personal income tax in the entire country, 3.07. Those S corporations are paying that, just as you and I and your listeners are paying that. What we suggested was temporarily increasing that from 3.07 to 3.57, and then institute your severance, your loophole. There's a couple other areas that we can get new sources of money. As we ramp them up, you begin to lower the 3.5 down to 3.4 and bring it back to the 3.0. That 0.5, not 5% now, point, a half a point, will bring in $2 billion, which is what we need.
That's what See our what deficit is. That's what our anticipated deficit is. Mm-hmm.
So, and it, look, they're not easy decisions. Nobody wants to raise taxes. I don't want to raise taxes. But you know what? Cost goes up. And maybe we'll get to talk about that later. One of the greatest costs is, you know, healthcare. But my point to you is we've made all the cuts we can. We can't cut anymore.
And working families need to be able to rely on the government to provide the services, the public schools, and to provide the other kind of services that only a government entity can do. That can't be done by the private sector.
And again, a misconception is too often when we talk about services, we're talking about, you know, an 85, 90-year-old person living alone that gets a meal a day and gets people to come to them. or the person that has disabilities, you know, and has special needs, or the children, you know. We're a compassionate country. No, we should not take advantage of those that are trying to provide for those people. Manage that appropriately. And again, the people's active participation in government will keep everybody honest.
Well, I want to talk about people's active participation in collective bargaining. Because one of the things that I see that seems to be a reoccurring theme coming up in the legislature is to limit the collective bargaining and to make Pennsylvania more like, or have Pennsylvania become, a right-to-work state, which has sort of become a national trend. And it's something that earlier we talked about how when unions were able to raise the benefits and the welfare of their employees, it ended up raising everyone up to that standard. Mm-hmm. What we have seen with the decline of unions is that as unions are declining, so is the standard for everyone else. But could you talk about how that's coming forward in our legislature and why that's become an issue in Harrisburg?
Well, remember when I told you there's a certain group of legislators that have been infiltrating every state legislature and also the National House of Representatives and Senate. And their idea is, you know, small government. Government, it's too bureaucratic. You can't get things done. It should be private industry, private industry, private industry. And the way to do that is to eliminate unions. So once you begin to change certain regulations, and I'm not saying every regulation is 100% perfect, but regulations came about because there were accidents. People died. People got hurt. People got sick. Mm-hmm. Go back to the mines again. You know, the mm-hmm. asthma, the black lung, because they didn't have exhaust fans. They didn't clean that air, et cetera, et cetera. I mean, we've seen that. And yes, does the EPA go too far? Well, maybe they do sometime. You know, trying to keep the Susquehanna, Chesapeake Bay clean so that we have fish and it can thrive. Is that a bad thing? Again, coming from the Northeast, I understand what an orange river looks like. I understand what orange pools look like. Many of the children thought that's the way rivers should look, orange. So when they actually saw a clean river, they didn't know what it was. So the bottom line here is we have a group of legislators coming in now trying to dismantle unions. And how are they doing it? They're trying to eliminate prevailing wage. They're trying to eliminate project labor agreements. They're trying to eliminate collective bargaining. They want to make us a right-to-work state. Geez, that's a great title, right-to-work.
Right-to-work.
Wow. Of course we want right-to-work. But every right-to-work state that is now a true right-to-work state, those employees are getting $6,000 less. That can be verified.
When you look at a national standard of workers, you will see that workers in the right-to-work states are actually, on average, earning less than where there is collective bargaining.
Exactly. And I'm sure that there are many of your listeners out there that have been employed by fair, honest, legitimate employers, and then those guys that were shysters. And the fair, legitimate employer, you don't need a union because they're paying you appropriately, as we talked earlier. The shysters, they're taking advantage of that company. And if it's a big company, what does that mean? It's you against the corporation. Who's going to win? But if you have a union, you now have rights, legal rights, and so on, of which you can do that. But I can tell you that I have 4 pages of bills that all depict and demonstrate how they're trying to actually dismantle unions and the power of unions. And why are they doing that? Because, again, unions now also contribute to campaigns. So that's the opposite of those corporations that are funding certain campaigns. And now you got to try to find that balance. Mm-hmm. And one of the ways to destroy or to eliminate that source of power, unions, is to begin to legislate it. And again, you do that by making Pennsylvania a right-to-work state. That will begin to eliminate unions. They'll be bringing people in from other states doing work. You know, there's a lot of things that people don't understand. Like when we talk about prevailing wage and project labor agreements, people say, well, when you do the union stuff, it costs you more. Don't forget that that union person lives in Pennsylvania, buys the house in Pennsylvania, pays Pennsylvania taxes, which comes back. It's not an employer that brings in guys from Georgia or Mississippi, mm-hmm. where that money goes back, which what happened with your Marcellus Shale in the beginning. Mm-hmm. It was Mississippi, Louisiana, Oklahoma, Texas, all the license plates. That money went there. It didn't stay here in Pennsylvania. Again, we're looking for fairness, balance. Of course I support corporations. Of course I support business. We have to work together. Mm-hmm. But there has to be a balance so that those workers have enough to be able to rise out of poverty and be able to provide a middle class wage so they can then buy the house mm-hmm. and buy the car mm-hmm. and buy the product and pay the Pennsylvania tax. That's how you win.
And you and I off camera earlier were talking about some of those things that collective bargaining has brought to us, both here in Pennsylvania and nationally. And one of the things that when I look at national labor statistics that always stands out to me is that still, in 2017, women earn less than men in an average similar work situation. However, that's not true where there's a collective bargaining agreement, where there is a union contract. Because where there's a union contract, regardless of gender, everyone is earning at the same rate. But could you talk about some of the other things that you were mentioning, and you've got a whole list of things that collective bargaining has brought that have become a standard that many of us are used to, have grown up with, and don't realize we could lose if we lose the right to collective bargaining.
There is no doubt about it. We will lose it if that group continues to dismantle your union building blocks. So what are they? And you, the point you made, which has to be made again, it was perfect. Those that are in the working force today think that whatever they have in their contracts was always there. Well, I hate to tell you folks, it wasn't. So there wasn't a 40-hour work week until we had collective bargaining. There wasn't an 8-hour work day when we had collective bargaining. There wasn't safety conditions on the job mm-hmm. until we had collective bargaining. If you're in a difficult job and you need a break after an hour and a half, 2 hours, something very physical, and you get a 10, 15-minute break, that wasn't there before. They would use you until you were done. You couldn't work anymore. Out. Next. Bring in the next guy. And then you suffered. It was also maybe time off. Some sick days. I hope everybody's healthy. But we all know that throughout our lives, eventually we get ill. And to have a job that will pay you for that day that you're ill, or that day that you had to go in the hospital for an appendectomy, and you're still getting paid, you know, for that week, and then you're back. Let me tell you, for an average person working, a middle-class person working, that means a lot. That's what it brought. Health and welfare plans, the end to child labor, the end to the breaker boys. Those kids were 12, 13 years old, dangerous conditions. And if you've ever seen pictures, they would be sitting on a board and they would have chutes of coal coming down. And their job was to pick out the slate. So just the coal went through the chutes. And believe me, it was dangerous.
How old were these boys?
12, 13.
And this wasn't a part-time summer job or after-school job. I mean, these boys were working the same hours.
Yes, let's go back. Now we're talking early 1900s, late 1800s, early 1900s. But let me say this to the folks that are listening: the men, if you had an eighth-grade education, that was big, because after eighth grade, you went into the mines to work because your family needed that money. So things have changed a great deal. But again, collective bargaining started in the early 1900s. And as a result, we have made this progress over a century, you know, of bargaining. And again, you know, has it gone too far? Maybe it has. That's why we still have the bargaining table. That's why still reasonable people and reasonable minds and reasonable ideas can prevail. But whether it's working assignments, because I like you and I don't like this guy, I'm going to give you the easy job and I'm going to give this guy the hard job. And the same thing you brought up about public sector. You're a teacher as a woman. I'm a teacher as a guy. You're teaching fifth grade. I'm teaching fifth grade. What's the difference? We both should get paid the same amount of money.
Yes, I definitely agree. So as we're coming to a close, I am just so glad that I had a chance to introduce Berks County to you. Because
it's been my pleasure.
I just think that your passion and your historical references, I've always been a history buff. I love the way that you bring that into helping people understand what's relevant today is grounded in what happened in the past.
Absolutely.
And I think a lot of people don't pay attention to that and they look at today's headlines. But I really enjoy your perspective. And I think that your constituents are very lucky to have you. You're so accessible. It was very easy for me to invite you and you drove all the way to come here and it's greatly appreciated. We have about 2 minutes left and I just wanted to give you an opportunity. If there's anything that you'd like to say or anything that's still on your mind that hasn't come out through the conversation.
I don't know. I said a whole bunch. I'm sorry about that. I want to emphasize once again, we are Americans and we are much stronger when we are together. Nothing should divide us. Whether it's Russia, whether it's politics, I don't care what it is. Don't let anything divide us. The second thing is please go find different sources, make sure you get the right information, and then participate in voting, participate in your future, your children's future, by being active in the political realm.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
You.
And to the audience out there that has been watching, I want to say thank you very much for joining us for this episode of Workers in Berks. We will be back next month, same time. I'm expecting that Richie will be here. I'm not sure whether or not I'll be here, but we certainly hope that you will be. And we'll be bringing you more information on topics that are of interest to working families in Berks County. Thank you.